Hey, how's it going, everybody? Thank you for being part of my channel. My name is Victor Sanchez, if you haven't been here before. I typically don't make videos as this one right now. I make videos more about my travels in Mexico, my build in Mexico. And this place right here is called Mazamitla. It's a very special place, about 3 hours south from Guadalajara. And today, I just want to talk about why do Christians support or with Israel. There's known fact that a lot of the Jews and Israelites are not for Christians. They tolerate us, but they're not for us. And I'm talking about more of the Jewish Orthodox Jews that are religious based, because there's Israelites and there's also Jews. The Jews are self religious. They're all Jews, but you have the religious sect that are basically taught by the Torah, rabbis, and stuff like that. So those Jews typically are not supportive of Christians. However, us as Christians, we are supportive of them, and we understand them. And I want to tell you a little bit about that story, about why Christians support Israel, and why it would seem that we don't care about the Palestinian people, because we do care. Jesus told us to love everybody. However, there is things that have to be taken consideration. You have to take in consideration the promises of God, what God meant for Israel. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. Okay, so it's going to be a little bit long, but what you need to know as far as why Christians support Israel is, as Christians, we believe that the promises of God started with Abraham. Way back before Abraham, obviously, but in the faith was with Abraham. The promises of the Messiah, the promises of the Holy Land, it started through Abraham. 4,000 years ago, 2,000 years before Christ, God called Abraham to come out of his country, was the country of Ur, city of Ur, which is southern part of Iraq. God called with him and his parents, they went into Hebron, and then came down to Israel. Stayed there for a little bit, there was a famine, they went to Egypt, and then they returned. Well, when Abraham was about 100 years old, he had not conceived no child. He's not going to have conceive a child, but he didn't have no children with Sarah. And so God told him, he approached him, and what we call a Christophany. Now, for Jewish people, they believe it's an angel, but we got to remember that Abraham worshipped him and basically gave his tents to the three people that came down. One of them is Jesus Christ as a Christophany. I know for the Jewish people it's hard to understand that. And you would say, well, what does a Christian have to say about their religion? Well, as Christians, we believe that it will be a time that they would understand it. However, let's stay with the story. God appears to Abraham and tells he's going to have a child. Some time passes and they don't have a child. They pretty much jump the gun, and Sarah says, well, you know, I haven't had a child. Why don't you go into my maidservant, my slave, and Hagar? And so Abraham did. Then he conceived basically Ishmael. Very important to understand where Ishmael is coming in the story. Okay, so stick with me. I'll try to speed through it as much as I can. Abraham then later on conceived Isaac, and the promise of God was fulfilled. Isaac, God asked Abraham to sacrifice his son to show his faithfulness to God. And you're saying, well, okay, I'm out of here. If you're out of here, it really means that faith is not for you. But God asked Abraham to sacrifice his son in Mount Moriah. So stay with me for a little bit. Okay, he goes up to the mountain, and Isaac says, I see that we have the wood, but where's the lamb? And Abraham says, well, God will provide. Long story short, Abraham's ready to sacrifice Isaac. Abraham holds his hand and tells them not to. Counts it as faith to him. And so Isaac lives, grows up, has two sons, which is Jacob, Esau, okay? Very important to understand Jacob and Esau, because there's two branches that happen here. We'll stick with the one with Esau. So Isaac had Jacob and Esau. We'll stick with the one Jacob. I'm sorry. Okay, so Isaac has Jacob. Long story short, Jacob grows up to be an older man. Then he has a battle with God. He basically wrestles with the Lord. And because he considers that he won, his name changes from Jacob to Israel. So now we're talking about 1800 before Christ, that the first name of Israel appears in the Word of God. And then he's promised that the land that he sees, that we see Israel now, now that is the promise of for the Israelites, that their numbers would be like the stars and like the sand, okay? So a lot of people think that that's just people in faith, but that's not only the people in faith, but also the physical people in their land. So Isaac has 12 sons, which is Jacob, which is now Israel, has 12 sons, which is the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, stick with me. Out of those, there's one that comes out, two mostly that come out, is Judah, and then you have other sons, and then Joseph. Joseph is hated by their sons, and they try to kill him. Long story short, he's picked up by nomads. They make him a slave into Egypt. That's how the Israelites end up in Egypt, okay? So there's a famine in the land. They all have to go there. The brothers and the father has to go to Egypt. Joseph is a ruler at the time, and then he basically, they multiply greatly in the land of Egypt. They're there for 400 years. They had favor with Joseph, and then the pharaohs got scared of how well they were multiplying, and they believed that they were going to uprise him one time. So he made them slaves. 400 years as slaves. And then this is where we hear the story of Moses and the great Exodus. So God frees them after the 10 plagues. God sends the last plague, which is the death of the first son. And this is where the first Passover is celebrated. Very important to understand these things, because as Christians, we celebrate the Passover with Christ, because for us, he is the Lamb of God that was sacrificed for our sins. This is where Jews and us separate. It's in Christ that we separate and we draw the line. But it doesn't mean that we stop supporting them and believing in them. So, okay. So now we have them coming out of exile. Now we're talking about 1,000 before, 1,000 AD or BC before Christ. And so now there's 1,000 years. They come out of Egypt. And so Joshua actually leads them into the promised land after 40 years wandering in the wilderness. Joshua conquers everything and everyone in the promised land. So 1,000 years before Christ, the land was conquered by the Israelites. So 2,000, 4,000 years before that, almost 4,000, Israel is mentioned. Now they're in the land. They have conquered the land. They are a nation. Within this time, there's judges. The judges call out for a king. That time there was Samuel, which was the prophet of the time. Even though he was indignant, God said they must. So they had their first king, which is Saul. Saul then was a good king after the men's own heart, but he failed and he sinned against God. And so God picked a king after his own heart, which is David. So that star that you see now for the Jewish is the Star of David. In that time, there was the Philistines. Very important to understand the Philistines. The Philistines have been there for a very long time. As a matter of fact, they're the warriors from the sea, even before. So they had never conquered them entirely. The Jews never conquered them. Pretty much had fights with them all the time. Okay, and I'll continue where the Philistines ended. So David now is an old man. He dies. He conquers the area. He unites. He unites with the north with Israel and the south with Judah, and he unites. Then Solomon is born. Solomon becomes the greatest king in the world at the time, the wisest man on earth at the time, or ever, given by God. So, the sons of the kings and the new kings sin against God and they forget God, and so God exiles them and basically sends them out to Babylon. So that's the first desolation that it's called. Okay, so all the people, all the Israels get either taken to Babylon or they dispersed. Later on, they come back, and I'll put the name at the bottom because I forgot the prophet's name. I think it's Nehemiah. So in Nehemiah, you hear the great prophets of Daniel. Well, Nehemiah comes back and rebuilds the walls, and then they begin the process of rebuilding the temple. I forgot to mention to you guys, during the reign of Solomon, they built the first temple. When Babylon took over, they destroyed the temple that was on top of Mount Moriah. What we know now today is the Dome of the Rock. Okay, that gets destroyed. Nehemiah comes back, it gets rebuilt. So the second temple is being built. That's a temple that stays standing when Jesus comes to the picture. Okay, the second temple gets destroyed later in 70 AD. So the time passes, the temple gets built. There's a 400 year period that there is no prophecies or anything in the Jewish community. And then Rome basically takes over the region and basically submits the Jews into the reign. They're still a region, they're still a nation, but under Roman rule. So then Jesus is born. Now we're at 0 AD, and Jesus comes, and the Jews reject Jesus. This is where we part ways, okay? But very important to understand that at that point, there was about 2,000 years of history, or at least 1,000 years of history, of them occupying the land. It's not until 70 AD after Jesus is born. Jesus now is born, resurrected, and now he becomes the savior of the world. In 70 AD, the Jewish temple gets destroyed again after the rebellion of the Jews against the Romans. And so the Romans basically started to hate the Jews because they were basically the worship of one God, and the Romans liked to worship many gods. Now we're at 70 AD, okay? At that moment, now, the Philistines has been gone since Babylon, okay? There is no more Philistines, and the word of Philistine doesn't exist for a very good period of time. Okay, stick with me, guys, okay? Still want to get to the point why Christians support Israel. And why we believe that Israelites, the Jews, should have their land. Not a shared land, but their land. In 70 AD, the Jews get dispersed in the second desolation. First one was Babylon, the next one was 70. Basically, they're not allowed to come back into their land. During the time from 70 on, the land was basically being filled with nomads, with different people. In 135 AD, the Roman Empire hated the Jews so much that he called that region Palestinia of Assyria. So that's where we get the word Palestine. Now, it was a region and never a nation. Now, during that time, now there's been crusaders, the Turks took it over, and then eventually the British took over it. Once the Turks got defeated, then they took over. The British people started seeing the need of the Jewish people coming them back to what was Palestine, which is Israel, Palestine, not Philistine, sorry, Palestinia, And the British people believed that they should go back to their homeland, which was Israel, Palestine. Okay? Stick with me. Before 1948, there was something called the Zionist movement. It was encouraged by basically the British, but the British kind of backed off a little bit because they wanted to appease the Arabs, and well, they needed oil. During that time, from before 1900 to 1918, roughly around there, the Israelis started coming in, and yes, there were clashes between the Arabs and the Jewish people. By right, the Jewish people believe that that was their land. The Philistines also believe that was their land. So, but it was never, it has never been their land. They never actually conquered it. They never actually ruled it. It's not until later that they have actually leaders for the Palestinian nation. But Israel has been there before. It's not until 1948 that United States declares Israel after World War II and millions of Jews die in the Holocaust. And United States declares Israel a nation. Now, Palestinians can argue the fact is that who is United States to declare him a nation? And for us as Christians and Jewish people, or who are the Palestinian people to declare them a nation if nobody ever declared them a nation? They just called it a region, but never a nation or a state. Now, in 1948, the President of the United States believed in the two-state nation, and basically the Arabs didn't want it. So there was a war. Israel almost basically won the whole thing over again in the Sinai, and then eventually gave it all back to create peace. During this whole time, Israel is always trying to be given land back to the Palestinians in order to have peace, but that land belonged to the Jewish people from the very beginning. Now, right now it's become a political thing of who you support or who you don't support. For us, it's a spiritual thing. So we don't care the politics. As a matter of fact, politic-wise, the Israelites and the United States are in the wrong because they're not focused on the spiritual part of it. Now, God said that he would bless those who bless Israel and basically curse those who curse Israel. So if you're one of those who curse Israel, well, you have just put the hand of God on you. And so as Christians and followers of Christ, as we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, even though the Israelites do not believe it, we honor the Lord by loving on the Israelites, regardless of whether they want to love us back. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, "Forgive them, for they don't know what they do." These were Jews and Romans that were there crucifying. A lot of people say, well, the Jews crucified Christ. That's true, and there's always been an animosity between Christians and Jewish. In the beginning part of Christian history, at least the 400 years of it, Jews persecuted Christians, and that's a fact. It's not until the Roman Catholic Church became a church, which I think was a mistake, to be honest with you, because anytime you nationalize a religion, it's not good. It has to be spiritual. It has to be biblical. And so I think the church started well and just has ended wrong. That's my opinion. Christians persecuted then the Jews. And to some point, the anti-Semitism is caused by so-called Christians. Not all Christians. Now, not all Jews hate Christians. So it's a mix of things, because there's Christians that in their time believe that Jews shouldn't exist. And there is Jews in their time, they believe that Christians shouldn't exist. And I think the sentiment now is maybe there's more Jews believing that Christians should not exist rather than Christians believe that Jews shouldn't exist. There's more support for Israel. We as Christians believe that the third temple will be built. And Revelation said that Satan will want to occupy the seat of God and call himself the Messiah. It's not until then that the Jews will understand that all along they missed the point that Jesus, Yeshua, is the one true Son of God. When that happens, their eyes will be open and the world will be evangelized by the 144,000 chosen Israelites, not Jehovah's Witnesses, not Christians on this side, but Jewish Christians. And then the completion of God's promises will be made. After the 7-year tribulation, when Jesus comes back, he will eliminate all the enemies of Israel. And then the Jews will worship once again God and Yeshua. And then there would be a 1,000-year reign. So we believe in the word of God. We believe the prophecies of the Lord. There's so many prophecies out there that in the Jewish prophets declare the time, the place, and the who that Jesus is going to be, that unfortunately for Jews still don't understand that. But as Christians, we have the second part really well understood. The third part, where they're here and we're not, because we believe that we'd be lifted up and raptured into God, taken, they're going to be much stronger Christians than we can ever be. So as Christians, we support Israel because we believe that that's the promise of God. Now, for the Muslim faith, it's not that we are against the Muslims as a people. It's just obviously that the religion is different than us. Either way, Jesus called us to love our enemies, and so that's what we do. I know for other people and other religions, it's they almost try to eliminate the other person. We don't try to eliminate another person. We try to talk about to others about repentance, talk about the Lord, talk about his salvation, his plan, his blood. Basically, the Lamb of God and his blood is for the forgiveness of our sins. The same blood that was used on the Passover when the angel of death passed by it in Egypt, that redeemed anybody who had the blood on the post, and death passed over him. Well, Jesus is that atoning blood for us. Death will pass over us, and we will be with the Lord forever and ever and ever. Amen. There's a lot to say about this, and for those who stuck for the whole video, I really appreciate it. There's a lot to cover. It's impossible to condense it on a short video as much as I can. So I'm just hoping that you guys enjoyed it, that it made sense, that as Christians, we believe way back then that the promises of God were for the Jews and still believe it so. So we pray that God blesses the Jews, that gives them wisdom in this war to do it right. There's a lot of media, social media, that Palestinians are using as a war. Could some of it true? Yes, I believe some of it can be true. But I do think that most of it won't. Because how do you believe a terrorist and not believe the Jews who did not go in there and did the horrific things that they did? Hamas did horrific things. The Jews are in war. And anytime in war, there's casualties. In my heart, the ones to blame is the Palestinians who were supporting Hamas. You know, it's insane how the Israelites are to blame. How do you blame the Israelites for defending themselves and to going after the people who've been captured? I was thinking, like, what would you do? What would you do if you're watching this video? What would you do if your child, your mother, your grandmother was taken? Would you be merciful? Now, everybody says, well, God is love. Yes, God is love. But there cannot be any love of God without justice. You understand? God is just. Now, God is also merciful. That covers justice. By his mercy, he'll forgive our sins and also help us through the whole situation here. Help the Palestinian people, the innocent Palestinians that had nothing to do with all this, and give wisdom to the Israelites to do this thing well. We pray for blessings upon Israel. We pray that the land would be given back to them. What to do with the Palestinian people? Well, as a Mexican that travels to the United States, and that's not technically my land, you have to assimilate. Assimilate to the customs of the place. In my case, I became a Christian in the United States. I got to know Christ. I didn't become a Christian here in Mexico. Now I enjoy Mexico. I can enjoy both places. But you can't have it both ways. You can't have it. So, my friends, thank you for watching this video. Hopefully I didn't ramble where it didn't make no sense. And again, thank you for being part of my channel. Appreciate it. Just want to show you guys something really quick. Look at this. How beautiful. It really sucks because you're watching TV and I'm here enjoying this. But there's a war going on in Israel and there's people captured by the time you watch this video, for almost 2 months. Who knows how they're being taken care of? The families are suffering right now, not knowing whether their sons, daughters, grandmothers, grandparents are going to come back. Pray for them. Pray for the whole situation. Pray for peace in Israel. So God bless you guys. Till next time.